Jay and I met Frank when we came back from Australia. We were living in Australia in 1995, and you were finishing up the master's by that time, or in the master's program. And as a master's student, he got a job as an intern at Intel in Chandler, Arizona. And so one of the things I will tell you about Frank is he cannot keep a job. AIG, and now Amazon. Yeah. And what is your title?
Director of Ops Training.
Director of Operations Training Amazon.
Wow.
And so Frank did his work at Arizona State University. I was privileged to be his major advisor, and we did some work on electronic performance support systems. Another thing you should know about Frank is he is a great example of a scholar practitioner. Not only has he worked in a variety of companies moving up the ladder along the way, he has published quite a bit of work. He has been active in either Guild, ATD, ISPI, ACP. And so, you know, one of these, a lot of times what happens is people get their PhD, they go off in industry, and they don't contribute back to the knowledge base. He does. And so that's number two. Number one, can't keep a job. Number two, he is a scholar. Oh, and I forgot there was a stint there at San Diego State University at one time. Another thing I would tell you about Frank is he probably changes cars as often as I change my underwear. So he came up, and my daughters were like, stick their head out the car, out the window, and they go, what's he driving now? It could be a convertible Porsche, it could be an old rigging truck. And so Frank likes automobiles. The last thing I will tell you about Frank is, honest to God, he is an American success story. His mother and father had to leave South Vietnam when Saigon fell. They were in the South, they were in Saigon, trying to get on an airplane when his mother fell down and was trampled. She was pregnant with Frank.
Quite a lot.
So some stranger helped mom on the airplane. And then their family was adopted by Franciscan monks.
Franciscan mission on the Navajo
Reservation. The Navajo Reservation in Arizona. So that's where he was grew up for a few years. And so, you know, I'm sorry, I put politics in here. No, I'm not sorry. You know, immigrant. Oh, yeah, I know you're born here, but my God, you know, that's the kind of thing that we should be grateful for, people like me. Right? So that's enough for me. Come on up, Frank. And
thank you. Thank you. Wow. I don't know how I follow that. That's really great. I'm not going to bother introducing myself. Let's just jump right into the topic, if that's okay, and I'll talk a little bit more about it. How many of you recognize this? This will date me. About half the room, right? So the other half of the room, just so you know, this is an Atari. Yeah, you've seen it. Probably at the Smithsonian. It's an Atari 2600. This was like one of the original game consoles, right? It's so old, so like just to imagine how this worked. You had this, you plugged it into a TV. The TV that my parents had was, it had a dial. That's how you changed the channels. I think it had 15 channels. Yeah, like some people are nodding their heads. And it was a black and white TV. And then when we upgraded, I had to move to a color TV. There's a little switch on here, if you see. Whoops, there we go. It says, flip it between black and white or color. Like, this is how old this is, right? But I burned many, many days, nights on an Atari 2600. To kind of move maybe a little farther forward in the sort of modern territory, how many recognize this or played this? Okay, this is a little less. So this is Fortnite. I think Yao, I'm not sure where Yao is in the room today. Oh, there you are. Andy, I think was your son. He was so cute. So he had name tags, and it had like first name, last name, and then like status. He had Fortnite as a status. It was pretty cool. Anyway, so I have a 16-year-old nephew now. Kyle is his name. A few years ago, I moved cross-country, and I was on the road a bunch. I'm like, you know what, Kyle, take my computer. So I had this big workstation I had built. It was like, i7 hexa-core with all this RAM and solid-state drives. It was like a monster of computer. He still uses it today. And so I figured I'm going to give it to him. He's going to learn a new coding. Like, he's like, oh, yeah, I'll do web development, app development, all this stuff. You know what he uses that computer for?
Fortnite.
Fortnite. That's all he does. So, and a couple years ago, my sister went on vacation. And so he was old enough, they just kind of left him home. And it was there for about a week. And she's like, would you mind just checking in on Kyle for every once in a while? I'm like, sure. So I go over there one night, ring the doorbell, no answer, whatever, wait for a while. So I just go through the garage, just like, is he dead? Did he pass out? Whatever's going on. And I go upstairs. He has like a little man cave, 16 in the man cave. And so here he is, computer, headphones on, like didn't know I was even there. The dog's emaciated on the floor because probably hasn't eaten for days. And there's like bags of chips and like empty bottles of Mountain Dew. And he's like pale, like he's a different color. He's been inside so long, right? And what is he doing? Okay, not only do that. So I'm like, hey, Kyle, I'm here. How you doing? Whatever. I'm like, what have you been doing? Like, I've been trying to call you, text you for the last day. He's like, well, I've been doing this. So YouTube, right? So there's this whole trend. Kids record themselves playing and then post it on YouTube. And actually, I'll show you a little clip. I don't get it. Like, okay, we'll take a look. Here, I'll show you kind of what it looks like. So here's actually my nephew. Whoops, let me go back. Actually, now I'm in this mode. How do I get my mouse back inside? There we go. So it all starts out very tame. Whoops. I think I'm in this mode where I can't play. Okay, there we go. So it all starts very kind of tame. You're just kind of driving around. And then it just goes crazy. Like, I watched it for a while and I felt like I wanted to have a seizure or something. Like I didn't know what was going on. And I think it ends with Obi-Wan Kenobi. Anyways. So this is what nephew does with his big computer that I gave him, right? But anyway, it's interesting to me because I remember early in my career we talked about generation changes and millennials are coming, baby boomers are retiring and all these things. And I didn't believe it. I'm like, this doesn't really have any substantive difference. But now 25 years into my career, I think there are definitely some sea changes, right? And so that's really where we have an era now where generations are growing up with computer games. And I grew up with Ataris. Now they're growing with Fortnite and YouTube and all these things. So what ramifications does that have for us from a learning perspective, right? So you've probably heard of gamification, game-based learning, those types of things. How many of you think about game-based learning from the context of engaging millennials of sort of this generation? Maybe you've thought about it from that perspective. Okay. How many of you have thought about gaming from the perspective of just making learning fun, right? Just kind of spicing things up, make it more interesting and engaging. Yeah, that's also something for real. How many of you have thought about it just because everyone else is talking about it, everyone else is doing it? Okay. I'm not sure where she is, but I think I was talking to someone yesterday about gamification when it first came. Oh, there you are. And I've kind of reached this point now where I've watched trends come and the trends go, and I'm kind of a little bit of a skeptic anytime anything new comes out. And in total honesty, when gamification came out, I'm like, oh gosh. You know, I grew up with games, they're fun, but it's just fun. There's Ruth Clark uses this term of edutainment, right? It's you're entertaining someone and not really educating them. So I was very much a skeptic. But I would have to say, having joined a certain organization with 86% millennials, where the population was high turnover, the products were changing all the time, I took a look at that organization. It actually does make sense. So I spent a number of years doing some really pragmatic work in this space, and I think I surprised myself even. I think I even overcame levels of skepticism and really became really kind of an advocate in the space. And a couple of things that dawned on me around gamification is, first big surprise for me is it's really a way to change the metrics that you use to measure learning in your organization. Number one surprise, for sure. Like, I had no idea. I didn't know that would even be remotely possible. The other thing that really surprised me is using gamification to actually transform an organization completely. And towards the end of this, I'll show you a couple examples of how that played out. Okay, so good for gamification. All right, how many of you have ever used or built or seen games like this? So in this case, you've got interactions, you've got scores, right? Okay. Have you ever seen gamification like this? This is actually a degree platform called Degreed. Okay, saw a hand in the back. All right, this company out of Utah. I think they were actually in Shark Tank a number of years back. Mark Cuban's one of their investors. The idea behind this is not so much about, you know, putting content into a game format, but this is more about taking the concepts of gamification and quantifying expertise or learning, right? So what they're doing here, this David Blake's concept was take a degree, feed in a transcript, and then use that information to populate expertise. So you can see here there's economics, there's applied economics, there's technology. And for each of these areas, you have point values and there's a percentage of expertise that you can gain, right? So it's a little less about learning itself, but more about quantifying learning using sort of game mechanics, right? So the reason why I kind of give you those two examples is that there are differentiations between different types of gamification, right? So the first thing I showed you around Atari and Fortnite, that is squarely in the space of games. That's just games for the sake of having fun. Or in case of my nephew, games for rotting his brain and his teeth too with Mountain Dew, right? And then there's game-based learning. I generally use the term learning games, and that really applies to the content itself. And then there's this third class of gamification, which is really about using game mechanics to quantify learning, and I'll show you actually ways to also quantify performance as well. And those two things actually surprisingly go hand in hand, right? So there's games, learning games, and gamification. Good with that so far? Okay. So we're going to dig a little deeper into each of these three areas. I tend towards the latter end of the spectrum, but I'll show you why here in a few minutes. Okay. I use the word mechanisms or mechanics around games and gamification. And so these are just three. This is not by any means exhaustive, but three that I generally tend to focus on. One area is really around the mechanics of a game. So the actual, you can see here, the vocabulary that you use when you design a game. The third is around the dynamics of the game, so actually how the game is played, if you want to think about it that way. And the third is around aesthetics. I would say that the mechanics are more important than, whoops, let me go back, because I know some people take pictures. The mechanics are more important than the dynamics and more important than the aesthetics, but then the other direction actually drives them. So I'll show you what that means here in a second. The design of it is actually derived from the aesthetics. So let me show you examples of just some different learning games to kind of get more grounding in these three areas of game mechanics. This one's probably very common. You've probably all seen storyline before, branch scenarios, and those types of things. The aesthetic of this particular game is a store. In this case, someone selling a television to a customer. That's pretty straightforward. The dynamics is that you're presenting the learner with some situation, right? In this case, they have an interaction with the customer, and they have two choices. And depending on those choices, they might go down a different branch in the scenario. The game dynamic that's added to this, the mechanics itself, is at the bottom. There's a score. And the way this works is that depending on whether you get the right or wrong answer, your score increases. And if you don't get to 5, you have to retake the whole thing. You might go down a different branch, right? So you can do branching scenarios. You can add gaming elements to it. But again, there's an aesthetic component. There's a dynamic of how you play the game. And then the mechanics of how you actually keep track of the game. All good so far? Okay, so let's add some more complexity to this. Any of you can take a guess at what the aesthetic of this game is? The board game, yeah, specifically? Yep. We did do a version with a game of life, with shooting ladders and whatnot. This was actually based off Trivial Pursuit, right? Actually, you can kind of see there's a little hint on the side there around Pursuit. And the way the game works is, you know, you hit play over here. And then depending on the number that you roll, you land on a different space on the board, and you get a question. And depending on how you respond to that trivia question, you get a certain number of points. If you land in certain spaces, you move faster and whatnot. But the entire objective is to get to that finish line with a certain score. That's really it. And if you strip all this away, I mean, so you've got the aesthetic of Trivial Pursuit, you have the dynamic of actually rolling dice and moving through the board, and then the mechanics themselves is just the score, right? If you really strip this all away, all this is a game veneer on top of a knowledge-based assessment. That's really all it is, right? But it's kind of back to those questions of why are you doing gamification? This one's really about trying to make a topic that's really kind of boring. It's financial services, like, oh, right? Trying to make that more interesting and fun. That's really all it is at the end of the day. All right, let me show you another game. Anyone want to take a guess at what the aesthetic of this game is? American Idol, yeah, it's a bit of a ripoff. We even have a bit of Ryan Seacrest, I think, on that. Yeah, there he is. Let me go back. Yeah, there's a little Ryan Seacrest on there. So yeah, the aesthetic is American Idol, right? In this case, it's trying to train salespeople on how to have the best customer interaction. It's a soft skill. People need some modeling, see how it's done well, and then practice themselves. So this is really the instructional phase of it. So the mechanics are you have different rounds where you have different customers coming in asking for different situations. And so the avatar would demonstrate a certain customer interaction, and then what you're asked to do is actually be a judge. Right? Was this a good interaction, bad interaction? Then you have a score towards the end, and depending on what your score is, you pass or you don't. Right? So it kind of gives you sort of a practice mechanism, if you want to think of behavioristic approaches, to basically look at role models and judge whether those are good or bad examples. Right? I hinted at this example. This is probably the most popular, well-adopted learning game we built over the years. The way this works is obviously the aesthetic is a store, like kind of a big box retail store. You'll notice some interesting things about the store, right? You'll see things like there's fumes coming out of a vent. There's, clothes hanging on the floor. There's a bear sitting somewhere probably where it shouldn't be. So the way that this game worked is that we were asked two things. One is ask learners to put themselves in situations they may run into in the store itself, and gave them choices in terms of how they would react to it, right? So in this case, you know, if you had merchandise that was sitting in the wrong place, the bear should be in the toy department, not in the clothes department, right? If you've got a bucket full of cleaning supplies sitting on the floor, it probably shouldn't be there. The other thing you'll notice that's kind of peculiar is you have sort of customers that look a little indifferent or confused. And so what those were interactions. And so what we were trying to do was pull data from customer feedback. How many of you have ever been to a store and they said, well, if you fill out the survey online, you might win, right? Believe it or not, someone actually looks at that data. And so it doesn't go in this big vacuum, someone actually looks at it. And so generally what happens is it goes into an MLP, a machine language processing system. We'll do thematic analysis, and we'll see what are, number one, the big trends that customers are talking about. The cash wrap person was rude to me, or the store was unorganized, that kind of those big themes. And then we also look for outliers, like just extreme examples of things that just shouldn't happen. And so one of the challenges we had from the business perspective is like, well, there are really great best practices out in the field. How do we make that part of the DNA of how people interact every day? And so what we tried to do was basically take that customer feedback and use them as actual real scenarios in this game. So when you clicked on an indifferent customer, you were presented actually with a real scenario that happened based off of customer feedback, and asked to respond one way or another, right? And so the basic idea of the game is that you clicked on a customer, and if you succeeded in your interaction, they became happy, which is the reason why that one has stars. And if you did not succeed, they turned into a zombie. Right, so this became known as a zombie game. And the way that the mechanics worked is that you had scores. So you can see here, here's the number of customers that you saved, here's the number of customers you turned into a zombie, and you had a score. And you had to score a certain amount of points within a period of time. This became so popular that this escalator that's here did not exist originally. What that took you was to the next level. Yeah, we ended up, like, by the time I left this group, they had 7 levels to this, which I found a little ironic. Because isn't that Dante's thing? Anyway. But what we would do is, like, you would pass the first level, we would give you successfully more difficult interactions. Again, taking customer feedback. And it was really our way of trying to drive continuous improvement for folks that even though they went through the game one time, they could keep coming back to the game. Make sense? Okay. So there's just some examples of learning games. And I hinted earlier about learning games and gamification. And so again, this is not all exhaustive anyways, but these are two other areas of gamification that I've personally found very valuable. So the first area is around learning gamification, which I showed you a little bit of, but I'll go a little bit deeper. And the other area is around performance gamification, which not a lot of organizations have done. I'm trying to do it now where I'm at, but I think is super powerful, and I'll show you the reasons why. Okay, so we'll talk about learning gamification first. This is a different system than what I showed you earlier. I showed degreed, but really similar concepts. What you'll notice, first of all, is it generally kind of looks like most learning systems, right? You have sort of what looks like curriculum down here. You can click on it. In this case, you can take compliance training. This one's around technology. You can see the sessions you're signed up for. But then towards the top, you see some things that are a little bit different. This first one I'm focusing on is what was called a Segno score. It's a lot like a degreed score. But the basic idea behind what we're trying to achieve was acknowledging the fact that learning happens. I say this quite a bit to folks, and I think sometimes they get a little mystified, but I personally think that learning happens in spite of training, Amen. Not necessarily because of training, right? People learn. They figure out what to do on their job, whether it's coming from us or coming from somebody else. One of the challenges that we had historically is that we don't really track everything that's really learning. So that's really what the attempt is around here. So let me take a quick sip. So what you'll see here is that if you kind of go around the circle, there's some focus on, I would say, is conventional formal training, right? And so the learning systems we have now track instructor-led training, classroom training like this very well, e-learning very well. But what they don't do is track the other types of learning that's out there. So things like informal learning, so reading an HR policy, clicking help in a performance support system. Like if you're a cashier and you don't remember how to do a return, why do you have to go ask someone how to do this versus find help to help support you in that moment of need? So really, if you think about the way the mechanics of this works, I'm making the numbers up, but an e-learning course might be worth 5 points. An instructor-led training class, if it's just an hour, might be worth 10. If it's a week, I might give it 100 points. If you're clicking performance support in a tool, I might just give you 1 point. It's this kind of incremental learning. If you listen to the video podcast from the CEO, I might give you 3 points, right? I mean, so there was an economy around how we did this. Feedback is super interesting. So we had lots of systems, as I mentioned, that gave you feedback from customers and also from peers and leaders. And I wanted to quantify that because I think that's a really valuable way of learning. So anytime you got positive feedback, I'd give you a point. If you got negative feedback, I would take it away. Yeah. I think contribution of knowledge is also an incredible way to learn. I mean, having to synthesize what you know and teach it to somebody else, I think is much more powerful than even the act of learning itself. So if someone contributed knowledge, I might give them 50 or 100 points, depending on what the contribution was. And then finally, there's learning from the outside. So people come to organizations with all kinds of backgrounds, right? They might have, in this case, you know, bachelor's degrees, graduate degrees. They might come with certifications. And I wanted to find a way to also quantify that as well. So all those types of learnings all contributed into this middle piece, which is called the Segno score. Degree does the same thing. Just the mechanics behind it is basically gamification of expertise. Quantification of expertise. That's really the whole underlying concept. One of the things that we did it's a little unique though, was a concept around degradation. And so one of the observations I had was knowledge is fairly volatile depending on what it is. So to use an example, something like instructional design, it's fairly durable. Like if you had an instructional design degree, like in my case from way too long ago, I think that's still fairly durable. If it's something like, you know, what is this? This is a Logitech clicker, right? This is going to be obsolete. Probably already is obsolete, to be honest with you. So if I train someone on this product, I don't necessarily want to give them credit for that forever. And so one of the mechanisms we built in was a degradation. So if you took training on this product, in half a year, I'd take the points away, maybe half of it away, and in a year, I would take it all away, right? And so it was really a mechanism to drive continuous learning depending on where the area of content was. If it's customer service, that's fairly durable. If it's compliance, that was kind of rotational every year. If it's product-based, it tend to move a little faster. So that was another mechanism that we built into the gamification. A couple areas that you may have noticed too. So beyond the score, you'll notice that there are medals, right? And so this is a concept that we put in place to try to put the right toll gates in for our new hires. So as an example, the two things that were most important to me for a new hire was keep the company legal and serve customers well. Right, so the two toll gates before you'd even hit the floor to talk to a customer was you had to get to bronze, in this case, in compliance, and you had to get to bronze in customer service. So consume enough content to get to that level, and then we'll allow you to go talk to customers at the very least. And then from there, it just varied depending on what your role was, right? So if you were selling appliances, you need to get to bronze in appliances. If you're fixing cars, you need to get to bronze in a specific area that you were focused on in automotive repair. It also allowed then learners to have the choice. You could either say, you know, I want to come in really great at what I'm doing. Like, I want to know everything about LED TVs, right? So now you can come silver or gold in consumer electronics. Or you could say, I want to diversify. I mean, there are dynamics of some of these roles which are super interesting, like margins in appliances, and therefore commissions are higher than in consumer electronics. So we had associates literally standing on the other side of the aisle where one person made more than the other because of what they were selling, right? So then what we allow people to do is have choice and say, look, I sell TVs today, but I want to do that job because I'll make more. And so we allowed them the opportunity to go and build expertise in those areas, bronze, silver, gold. And when a job came up and you had two candidates, one with no expertise and one already with expertise they'd built up on their own, of course you would choose the latter, right? Okay. I already talked about that enough. So I think the biggest revelation for me in doing learning gamification, which took me far too long to realize, quite honestly, was that gamification was a little less about the games and the dynamics and engaging millennials and trying to make it fun. What it's really about is taking existing data you already have and adding a gamification data, a layer that produces new metadata. And that extra data that you're producing is super, super powerful. And I'll show you a couple examples of how that works. So if you take nothing away from today, and I will show this slide again, take this. This is really the lesson I have around gamification. I have no idea why I put this slide back in. All right. How many of you have ever had your credit score run before? Okay. Very common, right? If you've ever rented an apartment, bought a car, bought a house. I think it's a super interesting construct. So I was really lucky when I was at San Diego State. Had a number of students that worked at Fair Isaac. Fair Isaac is the company behind FICO. And so I got a really deep look at how the mechanisms actually work. And so just to kind of simplify it, I think that's maybe an old deck, I just realized. Let me move forward. Okay, I'll show you this version instead. Really kind of simplify it. What it's really doing is taking six existing data points, right? So it's looking at the number of inquiries you've had on your credit report, the total number of accounts you have in your credit report, the average age of your credit, the number of derogatory marks, so things like bankruptcies and, you know, those types of things, foreclosures, the utilization of your credit cards, so if you have $1,000, $10,000 limit, what percentage of that limit are you using, and then your payment history. So it takes those six factors, and depending on the version of the FICO score, it runs it through an algorithm, and then it spits out a number, right? So in this case, it spits out on April 7th, 828. I think this one's at 850 or something like that, is this example. And companies use that number as an objective measure of your performance as a consumer. Right, you could walk into any bank today and say, well, they'll probably run it, right? But they'll see, okay, you have an 828, therefore, we're gonna give you this interest rate for a car. It's very objective, it's very measured, it's very structured. I find that super fascinating. The other thing I find fascinating is this sort of longitudinal view, right? You can kind of see how you're performing. There's a drop here for whatever reason. But you can see it longitudinally over a series of months, series of years, and how this individual is performing. Super interesting. So I looked at this and thought, I wonder if there's a way to use that same basic idea to do that for every employee in a company every day. You know, I know Jim, I were talking yesterday about performance management, if you don't mind me sharing, Jim. Like, you the process you go through as an academic, just so you know, right? You have an annual process, and then if you're a doc candidate, you'll go for RTP. So every year you'll look at, you know, working towards tenure and then promotion. It's a rigorous process, right? I think there's quite a bit of documentation and writing in that. Even the company I'm in right now, I have to be honest, I'm surprised at how it's somewhere in between a very modern performance management approach and very GE, like 1960s approach, some hybrid in between the two. In this particular case, we were trying to drive towards something that hadn't been done before. So let me show you what we came up with. So this example is specifically on mattress, but we actually did this with quite a number of business units. But basically the way this worked is the first conversation I'd have with a senior business leader is, look, bring in this meeting the list of metrics that you measure your business. That was the very first ask. And so usually they would bring this list that was like miles long, right? Okay, so that was the first part of the list, first part of the ask. And then the conversation went something like, out of this list, what are like the 3 to 5 most important things that you would pay attention to every day? Right, so it was really kind of this winnowing process from hundreds to 3 or 5, which was very difficult for many leaders to do. It's like, okay, are there metrics that are more important than others? Some of them said yes. In this example, Steve, I should have pushed him harder, he said, these are my 4, but they're all equally about the same. And this is where it started, but this is not where it ended, by the way. It evolved over time. So we said, okay. So in this case, the four metrics that he focused on, something called CPH, contribution per hour. It's a sales metric. It's like sales revenue, basically. Premium balance of sale. That's basically like the size of the shopping cart. Like obviously you want to sell more in a transaction as possible. The third metric he cared about was something called accessories per $100. And so it probably shouldn't be a surprise to you, but companies, the biggest margin isn't in the product that you're buying, but actually in the accessories attached to the product, right? And then finally, this is also very peculiar to this business, is something called return exchange. This is probably good news for you, but if you ever buy a mattress and you return it, they throw it away. They don't discount mattresses. So this impacted this business in particular very interestingly, because if you buy a $1,000 mattress and you upsell someone on it and decide they don't want it, like you bring it back, that's $1,000 out the window, right? So to this business leader, he said, these are the four things I care about, and right now I care about them in equal amounts. I said, okay, we'll start with there. All right, so the way this worked is that every month, the clock reset. So it was actually a monthly performance management cycle, but you had insight every day on how you were performing. So in this case, this is David Smith, and on this particular day, his dream score is what we called it for this business, was 387. And in this particular business, usually we were doing ranges of 0 to 800. In this business, the senior leader really wanted to do it at a 400 scale. In hindsight, it probably did too much compression. Like I should have forced an 800. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. But what it allowed any associate to do is on a daily basis see how they're performing objectively and also see how they're performing against their peers. And it could be their peers in a store, in a region, nationally. I think this view is nationally. So David was ranked 360 out of 2,102 people across the country. So we can kind of see, you know, he's kind of in the upper tier. The other thing that was interesting is you can kind of see his performance over the month. So at the beginning of the fiscal month, he had a score of 200, it kind of dropped, and then he kind of ramped up, and then he plateaued, did really well for the rest of the month, basically. And he also can compare himself to everybody else, right? So that's actually what that green is beneath. So he has his own score, and he has everyone else's score, so we can see how he's doing in relation to everybody else on a daily basis. Right, and allowed them to focus on specific metrics. So actually, let me drill into the metrics a little bit more. So I mentioned earlier this particular business, they had four metrics they wanted to focus on. And what we did with each metric was set goals. And this is nothing new in performance management at all. But the goals that we had, again, were gamified. And so what we said for each sales associate in this case is, okay, in the case of accessories per $100, we would like you to get to $12.60. If you can get to $12.60, that is your bare minimum goal. You will achieve a score of 100 out of 100. If you exceed that goal, in this case, 1330 in silver, you'll not only get a score of 100, but your bonus will increase. If you get to gold, $14, your bonus will increase even more. Right. So in this case, David did really well. His metric was actually at $18.71. Did really, really well. And so a lot of times what we'd also use this data for was, I hate to say it, to slide the goals as we progressed. So you can imagine as folks did better and better in accessories per hour, next month the goals actually increased. So instead of being 1260 being the floor, it might be 1330 is the floor. And then we'd increase the silver and gold thereafter, if that makes sense, right? So it allows us to have an objective measure of where people are and continually raise the bar, so to speak. I hate to use that term, but that's probably the best analogy. You can also see below here, mattress return. David was averaging about 1%. So he did beat the 6% bronze goal, so he got his 100 points. He did hit 3% goal, so he got an extra bonus, but he did not reach the gold level goal. So he didn't get that additional bonus beyond that. Right, so this is tying not just your performance, but now actually to your compensation. So if David wants to get that extra bonus, he's gonna have to drive his return rate down. No one has to tell him what to do, he can actually see the data, if that makes sense, all right? This is a example of where someone's under goal. So you can see here, this is contribution per hour. Again, this is that sales revenue metric. In this case, the goal for bronze was 58.5. At this point in the month, he was hitting 58.43, so he got 90 out of 100. That's roughly, you know, not quite 100%, so we gave him a little bit. So again, have a series of time to try to close that goal to get to bronze and get a full dream score of 400. But again, clear delineation of where they're overperforming as well as underperforming and how they can close that gap. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, so I promised you earlier that gamification isn't just about entertainment, but it's actually really about how do you change how you measure learning and then how do you impact the organization. So let's talk about that first part first. How does measurement and metrics actually change? Okay, all of you, you're all probably familiar with Don Kirkpatrick, right? So let me think about it. I actually met Don, it might have been, I don't know, about 15 years ago. I was at a book signing at ATD. So it was actually really funny. So it was Don Kirkpatrick to my right, Ruth Clark to my left. So the way the line worked was there were like three or four people for Ruth. Ruth is great, by the way. She's a wonderful person. I love Ruth to death. There's like one or two people for me. Don had a line of like 50 people. It was like out the door. It was unbelievable. But I mean, you know, very deserved. I think the way gamification plays out, I mentioned earlier that gamification allows you to take existing data, add a gamification layer, and produce new data that sits on top of that. And that's really how I think about it in terms of the Kirkpatrick's levels, right? I glossed over it earlier, but if you notice on one of the slides, I had ratings for content, right? And you've seen this probably on Amazon. You see products, you see 4.5 stars or 5 stars or 2 stars, and that gives you judgment in terms of the value of that product. And you see that in more and more learning systems, and that's meant to add value to that content, right? And so if you look at that, I think that really falls in between, it's a layer above just general reaction or attitudinal scores. It's really kind of aggregated ratings, right? So that's kind of like this Kirkpatrick level 1.5, and it gets you closer to 2. The other examples I showed you around expertise gamification, so that Segno score and degree score, that's really around expertise gamification. I think that sits somewhere above, you know, level 2, almost moving to level 3. But because you're moving closer, it allows you to correlate your data to that behavioral data in much more powerful ways, and I'll show you a few examples of that. And then there's this other example I showed around performance gamification. That sits somewhere above individual behaviors and gets you much closer to tying it to business results, right? So gamification, again, is not just about entertainment. It's about producing that data that allows you to uplift your data and bring it closer and actually prove the interventions or really prove the impact of the interventions that you're building, okay? So let me show you a couple examples of what that looks like. So this is from a call center. The first thing to note is that the blue bars are folks who self-selected. Everyone was given the opportunity to participate in these gamification platforms. The blue ones were the ones who self-selected into them. The orange ones, for whatever reason, chose not to, right? So it was not a pure controlled A-B tests, but very much more about self-selection. So there's something in that as well. However, what we can see here is agent interaction score. So this is a measure of, it's basically like a customer service score, if you want to think about it. Generally, after you get up a call, someone says, hey, do you want to rate this call? And you can press 1 to 10. That's agent interaction score. So you can see here, over the course of 4 weeks, there's much more clear trend between those two groups towards the end. Net promoter score is also a measure of customer service. It kind of asks you, would you refer this company to a friend of yours? You can also see how that played out over 4 weeks. First contact resolution is a measure in the call centers around, if you called someone the first time, did they solve your problem? And actually, I tend towards that metric more than the others. Anyway, you can kind of see the differentiation in this space around those metrics for adopters and non-adopters of gamification. This is also a call center. This was an inbound sales call center for parts. Right, so a little different than the previous one. But we can see here is actually instead of looking at week by week, this looked over year over year. So in previous years, we did not have a gamification platform. In 2016, this organization, we implemented it. And you can see there's about a 15% difference in sales per hour. There's a notable increase in agent interaction and also net promoter score and also first contact resolution. So consistently across the board, not just from satisfaction, but more importantly to the business, here's how we actually increased dollars for you. Per person, right? This is from seasonal. So the way this business worked is generally we would roll out product at a certain point in the fiscal year, usually about April 15th. And then prior to that, we would start what we called an expertise campaign. And so what we tried to do was develop the knowledge of folks in the field about those products before they hit the floor. I mean, it's pretty straightforward. That generally started about 2 or 3 weeks prior. So you can see here, this is where the fiscal week started. That's what this dotted line indicates. And so we started the training about here. The blue line was the previous year, and the orange line was the year that we started this expertise campaign. I won't give you the exact numbers, but you can kind of see how it trends out over the course of about 2 months. Right, a clear separation between those two treatments. To quantify it, in 2015, it was $87.89, and the following year is $132.78. I don't think 26% is correct, but you can judge the magnitude of the increase of sales. This was Lawn and Garden. And so again, we offered training to folks who basically sold lawnmowers and weed whackers and those types of things. Generally, those things are sold in the spring to summer, so that's where the fiscal weeks align. And so the folks that are in gray are the ones that everybody was offered training, but those are the ones who actually self-selected into it and developed their expertise. The yellow were the ones who did not over the course of many, many months. This was back to that matrix example. This is balance of sale. The blue did not develop their expertise. The orange did. Accessories per hour. I mean, I literally had so many of these, I could go on and on and on. But I think you get the basic idea. Look, I've been doing this 25 years. This organization I'd led was about 20 years into it. I'd never, at that point, had the opportunity to measure the impact of my organization in the same way that I did completely accidentally in this situation. Because I used to own just the learning metrics. In this case, I wanted to try to find a way to gamify performance. And all of a sudden, I fell into the situation where I owned both the learning data and the performance data at the same time. Completely accidental. But now I'm trying to be a bit more intentional about it, what I'm doing right now. But anyhow, so that's how you can change how you measure the impact of what you do. Let me talk a little bit about transformation, because I think, Demetrius, I have about 15 minutes left, right? Okay, excellent. Thank you, sir. All right, how do you transform the organization through gamification and through data? How many of you are familiar with an IVR, Integrated Voice Response System? That's a couple people. So this is completely out of the call center world. What an IVR is, anytime you've called in, like let's say you're booking an airline flight or changing your flight, it says press 1 to blah, 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 press 2. That's an IVR, right? And what it's trying to do is route you to the proper individual that has the knowledge to help you. And so the way the IVRs traditionally worked is that they were very, very static. They would basically say, this group of people service parts, this group of people did delivery, this group of people did something else. I remember this organization, when I walked into the call center, it was complete madness. It was a group of about 500. It was about 500-seater building. This group of people, you could tell, were like frantic. They were disheveled. They were on the phone. The lights, like typically call centers have all these lights. It was like you know, Central Square, like in New York. And this group of people were just like hanging out. Like they were kind of on Facebook and on YouTube. And I asked the call center leader, I'm like, what's going on? Well, you know, this part of the business, which in this case was parts, was super busy, and its other parts was not. I'm like, well, why can't you take those people and put them over here? I'm like, well, because these people have been trained for it and these have not, right? So that was the basic reason why. And so after we went through this expertise and performance gamification process, it allowed us to do some things that we weren't able to do before. So integrated voice response systems, most of the modern ones have something called a competency module. Most people never use the competency module, but basically what it's supposed to do is say, hey, Jane has competency in this area, these five areas, I only have it in two. If a call comes in, it'll look at both of us and say, Jane's available or Frank's available, and route the call. Most people don't ever use this module. They use this very static approach. Well, now that we had specific data about what people knew, we could actually load data into the competencies and route people that way, right? So we would take who had bronze, silver, gold expertise in a certain area and load them into this competency system. And at that later points, we even got a little more sophisticated. So based off caller ID, we could tell who you were, right? And if you were a premium customer, instead of sending you to a bronze level agent, we'd actually route you to a gold level agent because we want you to have better service, right? So anyway, again, some of the ways that gamification allows you to collect data to actually not just help prove the impact of your organization, but actually help the organization become better, which I think is super interesting. This is another example. So this one is, these are field technicians going out to repair appliances out in the field. And so the way this worked is in the past, you would go into a system and try to schedule your appointment. And you'd say, you know, I have a refrigerator, it's a side-by-side, and it runs too long, and yes, I have an agreement. And we would say, well, you know, for $95, we can come out to your location at a certain date and time. Now that we had this expertise data, we could actually give you an additional choice. And it went something like this. These are the five technicians in your area. Here's their level of expertise. Here are their medals. Which one would you like to come to your home? Right. And then actually, we even took a step further beyond this, where this then fed into their, they had iPhone pluses. This is how long ago this was, I guess. And it would actually look at the customer and see the specific model that they purchased. It would try to proactively feed you data about that. So if we knew that it was a Kenmore refrigerator with a specific model that runs too long, we had many, many videos or technical manuals that show you how to do it, and we try to give you that information before you even walked in the door. Right? Because what you'd rather be able to do is have someone come to your door and say, hey, I understand you have this refrigerator, you're having this problem, I think I know how to fix it, you're in and out in a few minutes, versus let me come in your house and figure it out and then go find out how to fix it, right? So just trying to decrease the amount of contact time for a customer and get them in and out as quickly as possible, right? Okay, as I mentioned, if you take nothing else away from this conversation, take this. Gamification is not about Fortnite, it's not about Atari. Those are all really great, those are all fun. But what it's really about is taking data that already is in the organization, whether it's learning data, whether it's performance data, adding a layer on top of that that generates data that you can use to measure your impact or really change the way that an organization operates. So I think with that, I have some time for questions. Oh, I'm standing between and lunch. Holy smokes, I just realized that. All right, we'll take minimum questions so that you can have lunch. Yes, please.
So for all the platforms that you're collecting this data from, do you have one set master platform, or is it a few systems that you're
Yeah, that's a great question. So just to repeat for the room, the question was, do we just have one platform or multiple systems? So I'll play back my life story a little bit to help answer the question. So Jim mentioned I took an internship at Intel. It was a 3-month summer internship. I stayed there for 7 years. So I built, first thing I did was I took their classroom courses and put it online as their first e-learning courses. And then I built a learning management system to deliver that. That stupid system ran for 10 years. I tried 3 times to kill it. Like, it just was the internship project that wouldn't die. And then I went to American Express, and they had, I think, 3 enterprise learning systems at the time. I tried for many years to kill them all and get down to 1. Didn't happen. So what I've learned is that because these organizations are large and complex, it's really difficult to try to get everyone. Like, you'll never bring one system that makes everybody happy. So what I've moved towards is a model of, you know, having that multiplicity of delivery platforms. But what's really, really important is to have all the data in one place. How many of you are familiar with like learning record stores, XAPI, Experience API? Okay, good. If you don't know, if that's not a new term for, or if that is a new term, please go look it up. Find out as much as you can. So like some of the organizations I mentioned here, we were one of the first to adopt learning record stores. I think still to this day have some of the highest volume. We're doing like 1.2 million XAPI statements in these systems a month. But what we're doing is aggregating all that data from when someone hits performance support in the system, when they were in one learning management system versus another, all bring it to one place so that we could actually do reporting and correlations with the performance data. So the learning management systems themselves, like, I've just stopped trying to bring them all together. But having a single place where all the data lives, I think, is super, super essential for organizations. Does that make sense, Becky?
Yes.
Okay. Correct.
Yeah.
How about all those other systems feeding that single record store or data lake, some people are calling it now. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, absolutely. Yes?
When you're doing, brought up that graph with the credit score, the performance, did you get feedback on what the employees thought of that? Because I feel like, depending on person to person, you kind of foster an environment of competition, which I guess in sales is what you want, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll answer that kind of in 2 ways. And I've had various discussions with folks here in this room about gamification in general, or even just performance interventions. I would never advocate to say that this is the right approach for every organization. As I mentioned, I was very much a skeptic of gamification. This particular organization being 86% millennial, being sales forces that, to your point, are very highly competitive, it made a lot of sense. I'm talking to another organization now where it also makes sense. But when I was in American Express, would I have done this? No, absolutely not. It was the wrong culture and the wrong time and the wrong place to do it. So that's definitely something to be very sensitive to, is when and where are you trying to apply this, right? I think certain populations lend itself better to this approach, for sure. Yep. Mm-hmm. I think the other part of that question, I'll come back to here, is I think part of what I thought we were going was real on generational. Like, one of the things I was worried about was, will this appeal to my 86% millennials, but then the other end of my population were actually baby boomers. Most of them were retirees, kind of this big divide. And surprisingly, there was really no difference in adoption or attitudes around it. So I found that super interesting, yeah. Anyway, sorry.
Are you seeing examples of this in the public sector as well? Like, we see a lot of this being really applicable in the private sector,
mm-hmm.
but especially state jobs or mm-hmm.
Yeah, I have to be honest, I'm not as close to state governments or even like academic institutions as much as I used to be. But one of the key conversations we were having coming out of this, so there's a consortium with the previous administration, which I think is carried over to this current administration, from the Department of Labor around providing micro-credentials to the workforce, right? So the idea would be, I'll make this up, like one of my good friends is Rob Lauber. He runs training for McDonald's. Previously he did it for Taco Bell and anyway, so the idea there would be, could you have a micro-credential around food handling? Like, once you've done food handling once, you've done it 1,000 times. But every time you go to a new company, it's not portable, right? And so the idea would be, could there be a neutral micro-credential on food handling that you could take with you everywhere? So that project did get started in, it would have been about 2012. I've lost sight of it a little bit, but I can follow up with you afterwards. But that's definitely been a germane conversation around using some of the gamification concepts at the federal DOL level, that makes sense. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As younger professionals, if we're in a position where we think that gamification could help an organization, but struggling with that skepticism from upper-level leadership,
yeah.
What are some ways that we could present this to them that would speak to someone who might be in that skeptical mindset?
Yeah. And I've run into that many, many times in my life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
From like other experience, like other
mm-hmm.
data.
And yeah, and the reason why I pause in the data point, it depends on the organization. Like if, I'm just to use my own experience, if I showed up at Intel or Amazon with a mountain of data, absolutely, people would pay attention to it. Mm-hmm. If I did it at an American Express or AIG, they'd look at it and say, well, you know, okay, well that's interesting. It's certain organizations are more about data and others are more about influence. Certain organizations value data, but they only value their own data,
right?
If you bring in outside case studies, oh, that's interesting, but it wouldn't work here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Without knowing any context for the organization, the culture, what I would generally recommend is try to find a middle or senior leader who is a bit of a risk taker. One of the things I showed on here was around compliance. When I started with that particular organization, I found the same exact business problem and it didn't change over 2 years. So I'll quote a number off the top of my head because it literally is ingrained in my mind. 9,136,031 was the number of compliance training courses delivered to an organization of 240,000 people in a year. And I pitched that to the COO 2 years prior. She's like, that's a big problem, but I don't know what to do with this. And then 2 years later, they hired a new chief compliance officer, Mark Semich, the best lawyer I've ever met. I brought the same problem to Mark, and I'm like, I think we can solve this. He's like, yeah, let's do it. Let's try. Right. So the number one suggestion would be find a leader who's willing to take a risk. Trying to find an area that's somewhat small and manageable to test, to gather data within the organization. And then once you have that data, you can use that data as a wedge to get into other parts of the organization. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Very different across the
country. Absolutely.
And occupation. And they change, they are dynamic,
mm-hmm.
they change over time. So do you have any recommendations for us to design a more sustainable system?
Yeah. So I skipped my intro because Jim waxed eloquently and I was badly embarrassed in the corner, so I skipped it. But one of the things I love about our field is the fact that you can take what you do and bring it just about anywhere, right? So one of the things I do very intentionally for myself, which I kind of fell into accidentally, but I'm much more intentional now, is I take what I do, which I would consider as learning transformation, like using learning transformation to help business transformation, and try to switch business verticals every time, right? So I started in, actually started in IT, and then I moved to high-tech manufacturing, and then I moved to financial services, which was really difficult, and then to retail. Now I guess I'm kind of back to retail, so I've sort of gone full circle on that. But the reason why I say that is I generally try to go into every organization with no preconceptions. Just because I did something in one organization, I don't necessarily want to do it in another. I'm actually usually very internally skeptical. Like, I'll analyze a business problem very deep. Like, you think about performance improvement, right? It's what's the current state? What's the future state? What's the gap? And I try to find other interventions before I go back to play a play I've already done before. And even then, I try to be very intentional about not doing the same exact play. Part of that is, one, to keep yourself honest to make sure that the solution providing is the specific one that will solve the problem for that customer, that client, but also to challenge yourself. Like, the honest truth, it's been 25 years since I came into school, and I this is the only way that keeps me fresh. Like, this is how I keep growing as a professional in this field, is to make sure you keep yourself challenged. I don't know if that helps, Lucas, but that's the perspective I would have on it. Yeah.
One more question.
Absolutely, Jim.